Ladies and gentlemen, hello and welcome to this new episode of Sartorial Talks. Today, I am a happy man, and I'm going to explain to you why. I have the immense joy, and I would say even the honor, to have at my table, here in the middle of our living room in Bourgogne, France, two members of the very famous Bonnet family, Franck on my left and Steven on my right. You may not know who these people are, but if you are interested in anything bespoke, in craftsmanship of the highest level, and specifically in bespoke eyewear, you probably know the Bonnet family. And if you don't know them, it's my pleasure to introduce them to you today. Franck and Steven are the sons of Christian Bonnet. Christian Bonnet is a very important man for us in France. I don't know if you know this tradition in Japan of, I think they call them the living treasures. That is to say, people who are artisans of such a level that their know-how is considered as being an immaterial patrimony of the Japanese government. And it's the same in France. We have the same tradition. That is to say, some artisans are so skilled and they have the science and even the secret of some very traditional craftsmanship that they are elevating during their life as a treasure of the French government and the French nation. And this is the case of Mr. Christian Bonnet, which is your father. Why? Because he's one of the last of the Mohicans who knows how to master the incredible heart of bespoke eyewear with tortoise shell. And so it is my immense pleasure to receive two members of this family here today. Hello, Franck. How do you do, my friend?
Bonjour, Hugo. Fine, thank you.
Yeah, Franck and Steven, how do you do, my friend?
Very good, and you, Hugo?
I'm very good. So I must just put a little disclaimer first. Okay, Franck and Steven, they speak a very good English, but they don't know that they speak a very good English. And on top of that, the problem is that they're a little bit stressed because they're not used to speak English. Of course, they have such an important clientele abroad, so they know how to speak technical English for your business, but sometimes they can be a little bit stressed. So I'm going to try to make them feel good and relax, because we know each other quite well, and having a little discussion of maybe, I don't know, maybe 30, 40, 45 minutes. We have, you know, as you know, in on Parisian Gentlemen and on Sartorial, we have no script, except we have a few notes here, because it's better for us to make sure we are using the exact technical term to speak about bespoke eyewear. So first of all, I would like to know, Franck, a little bit about the history, because, you know, we live in a period now that a lot of artisan or craftsmanship houses, sometimes they, you know, they tweak a little bit the reality. Mm. And everybody is an artisan and everybody is a craftsman since whatever the, you know, 1930-something or even 18-something. And so people are a little bit using this revival of tradition. We call it, it's the marketing of dust, we call it exactly. You know, when it's dusty, it's good for the image these days. Right. But I know that the Bonnet house has a real history. Can you tell us, in a few sentences, in a few ideas, when was the Maison Bonnet created? And I think it was by your grandfather or your great-grandfather?
My great-grandfather was the first glassmaker of our family.
Yes.
It was in the Jura, the place we were invented the glasses.
Yes.
But he has not founded the Maison Bonnet. My grandfather in 50 moved to Paris to found Maison Bonnet.
Okay, so the great-grandfather was called Alfred?
Alfred, yeah.
And your grandfather was called,
Robert,
it's written here,
Robert. Sorry. Yeah.
So Robert is the real founder of Maison Bonnet.
Yeah.
So you spoke about, what's the name of the town? Moret?
Moret in the Jura.
Jura. So for the people who don't know, because we have followers from all around the world, specifically in the USA and around the world in Asia and everywhere in the Middle East. The Jura, it's a mountain in France. This is a kind of a mid-sized mountain. It's not the big mountain like the Alps. It's more like a middle-height mountain.
Yeah,
is that correct?
Near Switzerland.
Near Switzerland, yeah. And it used to be the cradle of bespoke, not bespoke, of eyewear spectacle making.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
We invent the glasses with arms in the Jura.
Okay. Your father, Stephen, it's funny because I love that. These are the two sons of the father, and then the third son, John, is also working. So it's a family business. So your father has been appointed Master of Art, right? As I explained, this is something very important. And I have a question for you, Stephen. You the youngest of the three?
Yes.
Okay. My question is, most of the time, people, they are embracing the same job as their father. Well, sometimes because, you know, it's a kind of a family tradition, but I know you a little bit. And how is it possible that both Franck and you are so passionate about that? Does it mean that you've been growing inside this atmosphere?
Yes, I think it's a passion for all of our family now, okay?
Yeah.
Our passion is our work. When I'm a small man, yeah, I can see the beautiful and particular people,
yes,
in my house, because my father worked for a lot of beautiful people.
Okay? Yes.
And after, I want to have the same relation,
yeah,
for my personal life.
Yes. So it was like for you a no-brainer. You wanted to do this.
Yes. Not for start. I think when the work changed,
yes,
when my family start with a different material,
mm-hmm,
I think it's the good time for me to come in Maison Bonnet, because it's not for me the real work of the craftsman, okay?
Yeah.
I'm more interested by the style, by the design.
Yes.
And that's more interesting for me to work for the new design, the new idea of the style of Maison Bonnet now.
Okay, that's very interesting what Stephen just said, because I may explain to you a little bit quickly, and Franck is going to help me about that, is that, as far as I know, your father and your grandfather were totally specialized into tortoise shell.
Exactly.
I show you what a tortoise shell is. This is the thing, okay? So to make things clear for everybody, the commerce of turtles is regulated,
yeah,
if not, we can say, almost forbidden.
Almost.
Since 1974 by the Washington Convention. So now it's forbidden now to kill turtles, to just have this, okay?
It's a good thing.
Of course it's a good thing. A little bit closer to the microphone.
Sorry.
Yeah, it's a good thing. But at the same time, so it means that all the stock you have is before the Convention of
exactly.
Washington. Yeah. So this is a treasure, literally,
yes,
right?
The story is my father with François Mitterand for fitting.
And François Mitterrand, the president of France.
The president of France.
Yes.
And François Mitterrand asked for the second one, exactly the same, really thick. And my father asked him, why a second one, exactly the same?
Yeah.
And François Mitterrand answered to my father, because we are in 73.
Yes.
And we signed the convention for
Washington.
Of Washington.
Yeah.
And buy what you can now, because
next year it will be forbidden. So you mean that François Mitterrand called your father and say, buy anything you can?
No, it was during the appointment, the last appointment,
yes,
during the fitting.
So you mean you were doing glasses for Mitterrand?
Yes.
Yes.
And my father asked him, why? Why a second one exactly the same?
Yes.
It's so thick. It's for two generations.
Yes.
And François Mitterrand says, because last year, it will be forbidden.
And then your father bought what he can find.
What he can find.
Yeah, because he knew it's going to be forbidden.
Yes. We work today with this stock.
Oh, wow, that's crazy.
Yes.
And so you are saying, Stephen, that was your father's idea it was his art, literally, to work with tortoise shell. And we're going to go a little bit deeper into this art, because this is fascinating, literally.
Mm.
But you tell you that you came into the company when, with your brother, you decided not to do only tortoise shell, but to open yourself with new material.
With a new idea, because when you try the comfort of the result of the real bespoke,
yes,
it's not only available with the real tortoise shell. It's
yes.
possible to propose that for a lot of customers
yes.
with the acetate cellulose, okay,
yes.
or buffalo horn, for example.
Okay,
and it's. More accessible.
Yes.
And
affordable.
Exact. And
yes.
Now it's possible for me to work for a lot of my friends. Before, with the real tortoise shell, it's so complicated, because the price is in a rapport with this very noble
it's
material.
It's expensive.
Very expensive, yes. Not really expensive, but because when you choose one pearl in tortoise shell, it's for 25 years, okay? It's
yes.
not really expensive. If you change 1 year, one big brand, okay, you pay more.
Of course.
What you say,
I try to resume what you just said. Basically, you said that, okay, I'm sorry, I used the wrong term. I shouldn't have that. It costs It has a high value. Value and cost are two different ideas.
Exactly. For us, cost, it's absolutely important.
Because this is such a rare material that if you want a pair of glasses with this, first of all, it's a stock which is dying little by little, is disappearing. Exactly. And secondly, if I understand well, if you want, for example, a very bright, very clear turtle, you have to take this little part, and then this little part, and then step by step, build a glass.
It's a real creation for the color.
Yes. Okay. So this is a crazy job.
Yes, it's a totally crazy job, and my father is the best of the world for that. And now your second brother work only with my father for these parts.
Yes.
For the perfect grief, for the perfect symmetric result.
Yes.
Because it's so difficult if you have the yellow eyes and the black eyes in the same piece.
Yeah, of course.
Yes,
of
the people course. Like that, for example, for sunglasses, for fun.
Yeah.
But for all the time, just under your eyes, it's complicated to have the different color. Okay, that's important to have the very, very good result.
It's a very mesmerizing material, I must say, because as far as I understand, the way you work with it is you use fire a lot. Yeah. Is that correct?
Yeah, yeah.
And also, I think it has some very extraordinary properties because it's made of keratin?
Keratin, 100% keratin,
so
like nails.
What is keratin?
Keratin is the material. The material keratin with azote.
Yes.
Is 100% of your nails.
Nails.
And hair.
Okay. Hair. So this is the nails and the hair of the turtle.
Yes, it's the nails of the turtle.
Okay.
The hair is more comparable. Comparable is correct.
Yes.
Comparable with
the buffalo horn.
Buffalo horn. In the buffalo horn, you have a fiber inside.
Okay.
We have no fiber in the tortoiseshell.
Okay. Can you believe that, my friends? I got tortoiseshell, I got buffalo horns, and I got these crazy people around me. They are doing the most beautiful spectacles in the world. This is why I said to you, I'm a happy man. And this is why at Sartorial Talks, we enjoy so much to receive these kind of persons, because it's not only, they're not only spectacle makers. You know, honestly, between you and me, everybody, oh, not everybody, but a lot of people can make glasses, you know, this, you know, I mean, you have glasses makers everywhere around the world, even around the corner, probably from your house.
Yeah.
But people using turtle shell, buffalo horns, this kind of precious material, but now even making the effort to use with acetate cellulose. We say it's celluloid, cellulose?
Yes, yes.
Acetate cellulose, exactly. Which is a noble plastic.
Yes, bio-organic.
Organic, bio-organic plastic. It's also a good decision that you took, I don't know, 10 years ago, something like that, to make your art accessible to a broader number of people,
only
as 12, Steven said.
Only 12 years ago.
12 years ago.
Only 12 years ago. Before it was only tortoiseshell.
Oh, yeah. So my question is, can you define for us what you mean? Because, you know, there's one word that we try at the Sartorial Talks to defend is bespoke. Because now everybody say bespoke, you know, as without really knowing what. What is your definition of bespoke eyewear? That is very precise, I suppose.
Yeah, yeah.
Tell me about it.
First, we can choose everything from A to Z.
Yes.
Okay. After we start rarely from scratch.
Okay.
Because the client needs to try things.
Okay.
He needs to project himself in front of the mirror.
Yes.
It's really difficult for him.
So this is why you have some kind of inspiration model, right?
It's a library of style.
Yeah.
Okay.
And after we have a really nice conversation with him in the first appointment. It's a relaxed ritual.
Yes.
During
I can testify it's extremely relaxed.
It's a relaxed ritual, and we for him and for us too, we take a notes.
Yeah.
We take a draw.
Yeah.
During this conversation, the customer's choice influence, choice matter, choice color, and we take a note, we take a draw.
And you take measurement, I suppose?
And we take a measurement.
Yeah, how many measurements?
15 maybe.
12 for the frame, and 6 only for the glasses.
Okay. So it's very, very precise.
Yes, really precise.
So does it mean that you give inspiration to them, for example, okay, I like this model, let's say.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then I try it on to have a first feeling of what it will look like.
Yeah.
But at the end, this is not these glasses I'm going to have, because the glasses I'm going to have is unique.
Yeah, exactly.
Is that correct?
Yes.
Yeah. So your job is to give inspiration. And I understand, Stephen, this is what you prefer in your job. It's to look for the style and try to choose with the customer the style that will fit him the best?
I think it's a complicated part because the Maison Bonnet, it's really near his customers. We don't want to give the style of Maison Bonnet of our customers, okay? We want to share the style of our customers. I think that's much better for that. A lot of people come in our shop and say to me, I want to try the Saint Laurent glasses. And I say, yes, it's good, but can I propose to realize your... not the same of another one, because the result is good because it's for Mr. Saint Laurent. Now, if I work for you, your face is totally different, okay?
Of course.
Have a large face, you have a large nose, and when I compare with the head of Mr. Saint Laurent, you are not very similar, okay? And I prefer work for you. I look at popular distance, I look the technical data of your lenses, because it's very important. If you have the big myopia, for example, when I choose the piece with you, if I choose the big piece, when I put the lenses after, the result is not the result of your imagine, okay?
I understand.
Because with the prescription, your eyes move, and the result of our creation is totally different.
Don't
we start with the technical data. It's our optometrist in Paris or in London give this technical data for me, okay?
Yes.
And when I have that, I can start the measurement just for my first proposition.
Yes.
And after, I prepare a real selection for the customers, because in the shop in Paris, we have 300 different pieces. But for you, for example, 10 or 11 is available.
I understand.
And my work, it's choose 10 or 11 pieces. It's absolutely good for you. And after, look your reaction. Okay?
Yes.
When I have a big smile when I try one piece, it's very good. It's a good opportunity for me, okay? Because I love when my piece is very near my customers, not before you, just with you.
So to clarify, ladies and gentlemen, what Stephen just said, you can see they're very passionate, those two boys. Okay, we had a little lunch before with some good champagne. So that's why, you know, we're in France after all. So we had to warm up a little bit, you know, specifically because we were all stressed a little bit with English. But you, these English, okay, they have a great accent. We love. One American said to me one day, he said to me, if you want to fool any person in America, speak English with a French accent and everybody will instantly love you. So I can tell that a lot of people who love you. You quote Yves St Laurent, that was one of the iconic clients you have, but there are so many others. But my question is something is a little bit more precise now. If I understand well, and we have to make it clear for the people, if you enter Maison Bonnet and you look at a pair of glasses that you want, you can't buy it. You can't buy it like that. Say, oh, I want this one. I take it with me. It doesn't work like that, right? You can't do that, really. You have to be measured.
It's possible if you have a very simple face, okay?
Yes.
And if it's... That's the same, I think, for the shoes, okay?
Yes.
For a lot of people, it's very easy. For another part of the people, it's very complicated.
So you would say that maybe 10% of the time, 20% of the time is possible when the guy has a...
10% maximum,
maybe
I think.
Maybe 10.
Percent maximum,
that is the guy said you say that his eyes are perfectly centered and the everything. Of course you shape it a little bit for him, but most of the time
after it's a decision of our customers, because it's possible to say, look the result now with the ready to fit, okay? Look the result, it's not perfect, your nose is not perfect, the brow line is not in the perfect position, but if you like the result now, it's possible to buy that now, but it's not the perfect result. If you want to choose the real bespoke, now you can choose the color, the shape of your temples, you can choose the thickness of your piece, you can choose the different curve, all is possible. And now after, the result for us is perfect.
Okay. That's very interesting, because actually it's something that people have in mind, they should have in mind. Personally, I'm a customer of Maison Bonnet since a long time now. Yes. I think I wrote a big chapter. We met through Pierre Cortet. You know, our friend Pierre Cortet, who is a good friend of your father too, because Pierre Cortet is a master of art also.
Yes.
This is the same idea.
Pierre and Christophe.
And Christophe Cortet,
So
this seems the same idea. Which is, sometimes I can't believe why in France we have this strange idea you know, that we are a little country and then our influence in the world have been declining, which is not true. I mean, we still have an enormous impact in terms of art, but also in terms of craftsmanship. And me, I have the luck to live both in America and in France. And when I say to the people I'm French, always have the reaction.
Yes.
I said, what, are you French, really? Mm. I said, yeah, yeah. And what do you do? Well, I'm a writer, and then they call me the Parisian show. You're from Paris? And the people are absolutely mesmerized. And most of the time they say to me, are you lost here in the US? I said, no, I love it in the US. So sometimes we have a false idea, but we have in France, and I don't want to be too much a patriot, but you know what, people? I am a patriot, because for craftsmen like that, this is so important for us to protect and to promote this art. So let's come back a little bit to your world, which is very mesmerizing for me, very fascinating, and I explain you why. Because what you do with your brother and with your father, I like this idea of a family business, is that you are merging high technology, because eyewear is a high technology, and specifically in France, we're very advanced on that, with the most traditional craftsmanship. I've seen this guy, and you too, but specifically him, working with fire, literally, burning your fingers to adjust. Explain to us, how does it work? Why do you use fire? It's bizarre for us.
Yes,
you know?
Not for acetate. We use fire for buffalo horn, and we use fire for tortoiseshell, because the matter needs to be, to have grease. Grease is a good term?
Yes.
Grease?
Yes, it has to be oil. Yes. So oil. Wax.
When you, with the fire, the pore of the matter open, and the oil come inside.
Okay.
And it's soft, and we can
massage.
Massage. We can do a massage with a hot oil to have the shape.
Oh wow!
Certain curve. This curve is not in the cut row. This curve is with a hot.
So flame. You mean you can't cut it like that? You have to shape it with fire.
With fire, okay. Yes.
This is insane.
It's straight.
Yes.
Okay. And after we move the curve with the perfect measurement of your customers.
Yeah. Because mastoid, you have a lot of form, and you have not the same shape in right and left about your mastoid. I don't know in English for about mastoid. It's a bones.
I don't even know the French word for that. Don't worry.
It's the bones. Yeah. You have sometimes it's flat ear and really big ear, and we have to shape the anatomy of your face.
This is insane.
And this is with a flame, with fire.
And you don't burn yourself anymore?
I'm burned in September when I come back to holidays. In October and November, I have the
because you self protect yourself.
Yes,
you
it's not really nice, but I have the real craftsmanship. You know,
like a heavy metal guitarist.
Yes, a little.
You know, at moment. This is crazy. Maybe. So. Are these glasses from a famous person?
Yes, it's Jacques Chirac one.
This is from Jacques Chirac. You remember
Chirac
everybody?
80s.
Okay, I'm going to do Jacques Chirac. Écoutez, je vais vous parler. Eh bien, bonjour mesdames, bonjour mesdemoiselles, bonjour messieurs, c'est Jacques à l'appareil. We like to love because Jacques Chirac passed away last year. I think he died last year, right?
Last year,
we were laughing a lot with Jacques Chirac because he was a very strong personality. And we were all laughing, but with affection, because he was such a big persona, and he was speaking like, écoutez, always he was doing this kind. And so when we laugh about politicians like him specifically, it's kind of an affection because everybody liked him. Everybody liked him. He was very accessible man, and he liked to, for example, we have a trade show of agriculture every year in France, and he will come, and he will drink wine and eat pâté, and he was a very, very nice man. So you spoke about François Mitterrand, so your father did glasses for François Mitterrand, for Jacques Chirac.
And Valéry Giscard d'Estaing at the same time.
Jacques Chirac is my favorite memories about president, because it was really generous. It was not fake.
Yes.
Because he can remember the name of our politician 3 years after.
Oh, wow.
You are Michel now. You imagine the guy.
That's
when
cool.
he is with you, he is really with you.
Yes.
He's not okay. It's,
That's when cool. He visited a different exposition in Paris,
yes.
And when my father is here,
yeah.
He stopped to speak with my father 1 hour, and the people say, "Mr. Chirac, it's
Mr.
time now."
Chirac.
But
yeah.
He's very curious, and yeah. He likes, I think, the unmanned.
Yeah, you know what? This is above any political opinions. Jacques Chirac was, and even Mitterrand, and even these people, they were above, you know, with for us French people. And I know it's different in some countries. Okay, you can be from the left, you can be from the right, yeah. You can be a Democrat, you can be a Republican, yeah. You can be a liberal, whatever you are. But these kind of persons from the past, they had something else. They had a kind of a charisma.
Oh, yeah.
That was really interesting. And there's something about Maison Bonnet, ladies and gentlemen. These people... And the father, you don't see him, but he's just behind the camera. Unfortunately, his English is a little bit not good enough. He's progressing, but he still have future, Christian, in English. But I'm just joking with him. He doesn't even listen to me because he doesn't understand English.
You can enjoy it.
Yeah. But the thing is that he's doing some gestures behind the camera. But the thing is that these people, you have no idea, their clientele is almost surrealistic. I mean, if we take, let's take some names around her. So, for example, let's take this. Which one is famous? Where's Le Corbusier?
This one, for example, it's Le Corbusier in Venice in 1950.
You may know or not know who Le Corbusier is, this incredible architect, designer. This is a fantastic name, right?
Yes.
And you design your grandfather designed this for Le Corbusier. No, Le Corbusier designed.
Le Corbusier designed this personal piece. Yes.
Can you believe that?
And
I'm going to play Le Corbusier for 10 seconds.
We are really lucky.
Okay, I'm the best architect in the world. Uh-huh. You know?
It's too small for you, but
yeah, it's a little bit small. Yeah, yeah. It's very strong, Le Corbusier. And then let's take another one. For example, which one would you ask to show us?
This iconic one.
Yes, iconic. Yes.
Personality one. We have
this one, for example.
Mr. Saint Laurent.
Yves St Laurent.
Mr. St Laurent.
Where is the Yves St Laurent?
You know the pictures of Jean-Louis Sieff when he's nude?
Yeah, naked.
Naked?
Yeah.
Naked. It's a publicity for his perfume.
Yeah, perfume.
And Mr. Sieff, Jean-Louis Sieff, asked him to put in back the...
So he was naked except he had glasses?
Yeah.
So he was not naked?
Yes, but we never used the pictures because it's Jean-Louis Sieff.
Can you believe? This is the glasses they created for Yves St Laurent
76,
himself.
In
1976. That Christian created this?
It was Papa.
Yeah, Papa. So you created this for Yves St Laurent. Can you believe that? And then I like this one specifically. So it might not be good for me, so I'm going to try. This is for the... What's his name?
Mr. Pei.
Mr. Pei was...
Architect of the pyramid, for example.
Yeah, the pyramid of the Louvre. He was a very famous architect. I'm going to try. The coffee is very small for me.
Yes.
This is tortoiseshell?
Yes.
Yes.
This one is tortoiseshell.
Okay.
And the Saint Laurent too.
Okay. Do you have a woman glass here?
Not today. We have Jackie Kennedy.
Closer to the microphone.
The 8 to Jackie Kennedy.
Oh, yeah. Kennedy, just for fun.
We do an tortoiseshell.
Oh, yeah.
But today, sorry, Sonia, no frame for women.
They did for Sonia also. You have, if you follow Sartorial Talks, you've seen Sonia magnificent glasses.
Yes. Nice
that is subliming her beautiful eyes, and it's from Maison Bonnet, of course.
Thank you.
And let's see a little bit more Aristote Onassis.
Yes, you can see this
one.
Two shape, I think.
Yes.
Yeah,
with the sunglasses in and without sunglasses. You have this one. It's a very special material in the medium color of tortoiseshell.
So Mr. Onassis was...
This shape too.
Oh, wow.
It was
Mr. Onassis was a fan of glasses. Huh?
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
Totally fan.
So for maybe you... I think you remember in the US, it Mr. Onassis is the second husband of Jackie Kennedy, right? Mm. She remarried with Aristote Onassis, who was a Greek. Yeah. Our director is Greek, so it's from your country, Cosmos. And let me see this thing, which is very clear. This is blonde tortoiseshell, right?
Yes. The real rarely worn. It's a very special one, totally yellow.
Okay. So I explain to you, everybody. You have to understand, in order to have this, you will have on this kind of tortoiseshell, you will have to take only this part here. So it means that you may need a lot of pieces to create that.
Exactly.
And this is the Rolls Royce of glasses. You can't make...
Yes, all tortoiseshells are the Rolls Royce of glasses.
Yes.
But the most rarely of the Rolls Royce is the blonde one.
Yeah, this one. It's a lot of work.
Oh, yes.
It's extremely rare.
Huge. It's huge. Maybe 50 hours of work to have...
Yeah, by hand, of course.
Yes, because before we create the plate.
Yeah.
Before it was a special craftsman only for do the plate.
Yes.
In French is tablotier.
Tablotier.
The tablotier creates the plate.
Okay.
And we recycle the plate and we with our pattern we design
like
on the
that.
Plate
yeah.
and we cut on the plate.
Okay.
Like that.
Now the tablotier n'existe plus.
Yeah, it doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah, and my father.
I like he was saying n'existe plus with the French accent, with the English accent. This is how French they go to.
my father to learn with the last tablotier, François Mondon, Jacques Rameau, the last savant of tortoiseshell.
Yes.
They learn to my father to grief the plate to do glasses.
Oh wow.
Because without the plate, you cannot do glasses. Look the tortoiseshell.
Yes.
It's too thin.
Yeah.
Like
it's the thickness.
Thin.
Yeah.
And
we need
to with a three or four.
Yeah.
We have the good thickness.
Yeah.
We grief the plate.
Yeah.
Together.
Wow.
For have the solid plate.
No glue. Only
okay,
natural
process.
So you mean
process. With this you have to arrive to a thickness
exactly.
like that.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
This is crazy. So. If some of you, and I hope many of you have bought my first book, Parisian Gentleman. If you didn't, you can still buy it. In French, it's sold out since many, many years. In English, I think we have a compact edition. It may be sold out very soon because I decided not to reprint it because it's a little bit outdated for some chapters, not for Bonnet. But I explain in this chapter something which is very important on your job, is that I think the title I choose for this very chapter was called Let There Be Light. Que la lumière soit. Of course, it's very biblical, but it's exactly what these people do. It's because, specifically with tortoiseshell, but now you can have this kind also of idea with, even if it's a little bit more blurry with acetate of cotton, but with tortoiseshell, you not only have fantastic glasses, immortal glasses, literally, that will survive you, but on top of that, he let the lights go through. And it means that it's literally lightning. It puts some light on your face. And never forget, my friends, that all this business of elegance and sartorials and made to measure and all that stuff, the aim of that is not to show, look at my suit, how beautiful it is. No, it's to make sure that you attract the attention with the balance you make between your jacket and between your shirt and your tie and even your glasses. To the face. We don't want people to look at your shoes when they say hello to you. Mm-hmm. And we don't want people to look only and they say, oh, he has great glasses. No, we want people to go through the glasses and discover your personality. And that's the main part of your job. This is why you can change lives.
Yes, and when you speak about different material, that's so important for the choice. For example, when you choose the acetate material, you can play with different shapes, different colors. For example, for you choose the blue piece in the blue swimming pool.
Oh, I'm going to show you
sunglasses.
I'm going to show you my
and I love
rock
that in you.
Glasses.
It's really funky. Okay,
not hey, too funky people.
Because a lot of people have this idea, Maison Bonnet is a very traditional house, but traditional for traditional man. If you're an eccentric man, we can produce for you a real eccentric piece.
You mean I'm eccentric?
Yeah, and you are not eccentric.
A little bit.
A little bit.
Yeah.
Okay. You have the blue piece in.
They call it the swimming pool blue.
But I think it's not eccentric when I see you, okay?
Oh,
it's not eccentric. You have the blue glasses, but you have the real beautiful piece.
Yeah.
It's not eccentric.
Yeah, but so I was. My question was that: are you aware of sometimes that you can change the life of people because you touch? Okay, when you choose a jacket, when you choose a pair of shoes, it's still something which is on the lower part of your body, but your face means it's a reflection of your personality. So this is kind of a responsibility in what you do.
Yes, and it's a bigger responsibility. When I meet my customers at the first time, I need a lot of information for prepare my selection.
Yes,
because... the classical man, it's different for this term. It's different for a lot of people. Mm-hmm. For example, I can say, oh, that's really classic piece. And yes. When the people try that, they say, oh, no, it's not classic. Not classic for me.
Of course.
And then I adapt my selection for that. But maybe I think it's important to propose your idea first at the first time.
Yes.
But after, I like to try different ideas. After the idea of my customers.
Yes.
Okay, you like the urban piece. Okay, I try the urban piece. But after, now I want to try another idea because it's my work and it's important for you to have our idea.
Of course,
okay?
Of course.
And for the lot of people, I think when you come in our shop, when I see the result of the design for the glasses,
yes.
it's not good, okay? You have the beautiful jacket, the beautiful shoes, the beautiful watch, but the piece is just near your eyes.
Yes.
It's not really nice, okay?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I prefer work when I see the good result in the beautiful woman, for example. That's more complicated for us.
Of course.
When I see the man with the specific faces, that's absolutely interesting for me. Okay.
Yes.
Because it's a challenge.
I suppose sometimes you have stories where you've been. Literally, we can say you changed the life of people with glasses.
Yes.
Did it happen?
Yes, it's a little impetuosity
to
take that.
Yeah, well, without being pretentious.
For us, it's complicated to say that, I think, yes.
Yeah.
For
but,
us.
But because in reality, I'm sure, yes. Because when I wake up the morning, it's for that, for change the life of people.
Yeah.
It's not for sell glasses.
Yeah.
You understand? It's we are. It's a big responsibility. It's huge. The steel Maison Bonnet. It's will be puissant, powerful.
Powerful.
And it's an ostentatious discretion because we have no logo.
Yeah.
We don't brand the profile of our clients.
Yes.
Never.
Yes.
We frame the gaze.
Yeah.
We make up the gaze.
Yeah.
We underline the gaze, never. We my brother Stephen explained. We don't want. We don't like. You have the really. You have the nice glasses because it's too much.
Of course, I understand that. But when I was saying changing the life, I was saying this in a positive and humble way. Mm. That is to say, I've seen it with my own eyes, if I may say. Some of your customers were. I think people may understand that. It's the same on bespoke tailoring. It's the same in classics. Sometimes people feel they're invisible.
Yeah.
Or nobody notices them.
Yeah.
Or they don't feel at their best.
Yeah.
Or they feel a little bit complexed with the world around us. You know, we live in a world where image is becoming so important with Instagram, with the social network.
Mm-hmm.
And so I don't say it's important to be noticed. But what I say, it's important to be comfortable with your own self.
Mm.
And that's what I mean when I say that I've witnessed people that was literally invisible, and it's not pretentious to say that, and you make them express their personality with it's like a superhero, extraordinary transformation.
Yes.
You told me so many stories about that, and people were unnoticed.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, they became not somebody, because who cares to become somebody? We're just human after all. But they were all of a sudden, they felt noticed. And they felt recognized as human being. And this is extremely important. I have one or two last questions, because we already did 40 minutes. We are very talkative. I'm sorry. I'm very talkative too, because I just love, for me, it's like being it's a wonderland to see all these beautiful pieces. And I know, for example, this one, I know what is behind this pair of glasses, the work, the craftsmanship, the know-how, the transmission, the sweat, the fire. It's a lot of things to do. But I know I learned something with you when the first time I did a pair with you, that you explained to me that most of the people who wear glasses, and now I'm obsessed with that because I'm looking at all the glasses, their eyes are not centered in the glasses, which is something which is very important, right?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, that's the most important.
Yeah, yes. We say eyes are the windows of the soul.
Yes.
And you cannot, you can, if you have...
it's difficult to have sorry for my English.
Don't worry. It's difficult to find.
It's really important to have nice glasses.
The right pair of glasses.
The right pair of glasses.
Yeah.
It's really important. It's not like a bag because, you know, glasses is accessory.
Yeah.
You know, Hugo, you have no sizing in our market. You know your size of your shoes, you know your size of your shirt, but what about your size of your glasses?
I have no idea. I know I have a big head.
It's an empire of ready to wear.
Yes.
And you are alone. You are lost in this big market.
Yeah.
You need a notice.
Yeah.
You need someone to...
To help you.
To help you.
Yeah. And most of the glasses people buy, they don't fit. No. In reality, because their eyes are here, or they here, or they here.
Yes, people say they hurt me. Okay, it's too small. They sweep a lot of my nose. Okay, it's too large.
Yeah.
Okay, what is your size?
Yeah.
People don't know.
And this is why bespoke means a lot in eyewear, maybe more than anything else, because sometimes we say, okay, bespoke eyewear, maybe it's a little bit snob, you know, to have bespoke eyewear, but I can testify that the first time I wear a bonnet glasses on my face, I have the impression I was in high definition.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, and I could jump with a parachute, and I will not lose my glasses.
Yeah, yes.
Because your eyes is in the good position for your prescription. Now you have a progressive lenses. You have three different prescriptions in the same lenses.
Yes.
And if your piece move, you are not in the good prescription. And you move your head for reading, or you move your head for a long distance, okay?
Yes.
But you are not really comfortable. Mm. Normally, with the Maison Bonnet, you can see mine, okay?
Yeah.
I can move my hand.
Yeah.
I can play sport. My piece stay exactly in the same place, okay?
Yeah.
And when you see that, for example, it's totally dissymmetric.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
Yes, look, he's a monster.
If I put one...
Yeah, look at that, you see?
1 centimeter.
You see, look at that,
Cosmas.
You have to see that. There's a lot of glasses here.
That's very important.
You see, it doesn't... It's not...
Okay.
I thought that to have a real symmetrical glasses, you had to touch, but now it's dissymmetrical because your face is like that.
Exactly, because look, if I put the normal one in me, okay?
Yeah.
It's not straight, look.
You're right.
Okay,
yeah.
And now when I put mine, it's not straight, and look, when I move...
Yeah, it moves.
Okay. And when I put mine, it's the old one, okay, not the new one.
Yeah, of course.
But look, my brow line is in the perfect position, my eyes too, my piece is straight, and I can move my head. The piece takes exactly
this
the
is the
place.
Perfect glasses for headbangers. If you like heavy metal, you can have it, you know? And if you can go to Wacken Open Air or any kind of big festival.
If you're a little bit excited.
Yeah, you can go and see a Mötley Crüe concert and you can headbang with your bonnet glasses. They will not fall. Maybe we open a new market for you, the headbangers. Yeah. And then, sorry, I'm just joking. Well, I think I would... have, I don't know, maybe hours and hours and hours to talk with you, my friend. You know how much I adore your father and your house. A few reminders. So for the moment, Maison Bonnet is as a beautiful showroom in Paris where the main atelier is for the fitting. And then they have, okay, I can give you a little secret. We are neighbors. We are in Bourgogne, north of Bourgogne. There are 25 minutes by car, and this is where the atelier is. And there's a lot of young people, actually. You are training a lot of young people.
More and more young people want to be craftsmen.
Exactly.
You know, in this world, in this plastic world, they need something.
Yeah, they need to be anchored. Yeah. So we are neighbors. And then they opened recently in London, 2 years ago now, in London.
2 years ago.
In a beautiful small shop in Mayfair. And believe me, being successful... on the British land, you know, French and British sometimes, specifically in rugby, we don't really. By the way, yesterday the Scottish, they won against the English in England for the first time in 38 years. So I'm sorry if you are British people, I apologize, but we are happy. And I just say hello to my friend Paul Walker, he's a Scottish man. I'm sure he's very happy today because this is the Calcutta Cup. It's a very traditional game. And for the first time since 38 years, the Scottish spanked the British. I'm sorry. What? That was my little... that was
congratulations.
My little, yeah, this is very good. So Maison Bonnet has a beautiful shop, bespoke, and what we call ready to fit. That is to say, oh, okay, if you have a perfect fade, a perfect everything, you can be lucky. But most of the time, you will have to go bespoke and really have your spectacles made exactly for you. They're in Mayfair. What's the address?
7 Stafford Street.
7 Stafford Street. That's very chic area, right, of Mayfair. And, of course, in Paris. Okay, during this COVID period, it's a little bit difficult for everybody because they have so many glasses here. They need to be fitted. Yeah. And then you can't really have your clients coming. But I'm not really concerned for you because you have a very loyal clientele from all around the world. I think you probably serving, I don't know, maybe 50 different countries. Oh, it's coming from everywhere, right?
Oh, yes. Yeah, yes. I'm from everywhere now.
Everywhere. Middle East, America.
Yes. Now we have the London shop and you have Indian people.
Oh, wow.
We have Indian people before.
Yes.
We have, now I think it's global.
Pretty much global,
And lots of American people?
Yeah.
They miss us.
Yeah. So everybody listen to me. If you really want to experience what bespoke is one more time, you know it's our obsession here, go to the real artisan. Stop giving your money to these big brands who just market. They sell the license of their name. Tom F, Giorgio A, Ralph L, and my personal favorite, Hugo B. Don't go to these people because they don't know how to make glasses. Instead of praying for a brand, a high price, go to real artisans. Go in Paris, go in London. If you have a big wallet, help to preserve this craftsmanship with tortoiseshell. If you have a normal wallet like me, go for the acetate cotton or for the buffalo horns. There's a bonnet glasses for pretty much every wallet, but these are real artisans, and this is something we have to promote and to preserve instead of being the victim of marketing and almost, I would say, brainwashing. Time has come, my friend, that we can rediscover the pleasure to go to real people, real artisans, more than ever, you know, and to really rediscover the pleasure of waiting and the pleasure, of course, of understanding what is behind what you buy. You just don't buy a pair of glasses. You buy a tradition. You buy gestures. And these gestures we will do with Sonia and all my team, whatever we do until our last breath, to defend it. Thank you, Franck, for being with us.
Thank you, Stephen. You're a great family.
We love you, and we give you an appointment, everybody, to the next episode of Sartorial Talks. And as we say, all together, we say cheers. Say cheers to the camera. Cheers, everybody. See you soon.